Good evening. My name is Mary Watson, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here to the New School for this exciting event tonight, celebrating the publication of Cecily McMillan's new book, which we'll talk about in just a moment. The New School, as many of you may know, was founded about 100 years ago as a different kind of university, a university where the free expression of ideas and exchange of the dimensions of social issues that our students and communities cared about were debated freely and openly on our campus. Now, nearly 100 years later, our university is a lot the same and perhaps slightly different, but what stays with us are those values of open debate and discourse and dialogue, not just about general issues, but about issues that matter to society, to the world, and to our communities. In more recent years, we've merged with the Parsons School of Design, so design is a big part of our complement of programs across the university, but we still focus on designing for social purpose and designing with an eye towards making sure that we're creating a kinder, better, and just world. So tonight, I'm happy to introduce this event, which is a partnership with The Nation Magazine, The Nation Institute, and Nation Books. The Nation and the New School have been in partnership for 12 years over a series of events, and this is just the latest in a long line of prestigious evenings and activities. The Nation and the New School are very good allies and partners in this work because of our shared value of creating platforms for dialogue about issues that matter. And so now I'm really excited to say that we're celebrating the release of New School's own alumna Cecily McMillan's first publication, first book, The Emancipation of Cecily McMillan, an American Memoir. Woo-hoo! Yay! Yay. Published by Nation Books. I also want to announce that the New School has a deep interest in the issues addressed by Cecily's book, in particular the issue of mass incarceration. For example, last year and moving into this year, we've had a three-year project with our Humanities Action Lab called States of Incarceration. This is a partnership of 20 universities to look at the issue of mass incarceration around the country and around the world. Our students here and students at 20 other universities created a traveling exhibition, which is now going to visit 300 sites. So it's being displayed in universities, in community centers, under bridges in cities, and around the nation to draw the attention to the various forms that mass incarceration takes. So our partner universities are in places like North Dakota and Louisiana, and in New York, where our students here studied Rikers Island, which we'll hear more about tonight in Cecily's experience. It's also important to note that we're at the fifth anniversary of the Occupy Wall Street movement, which to me seems like just yesterday, so it just goes to show that time does go faster when you're getting older. And tonight we're really excited to have this roundtable discussion of activists in the space of prison reform to talk about, among other things, how privilege can be used as a tool for social justice in action that's designed to try to create positive change. Cecily is joined by a distinguished panel, five Mualimm-ak, J-Lo Calderon, Hernan Carvente, Renee Feltz, and Andy Stepanian, who will be our moderator tonight. Andy's going to read us the bios of all the panelists, so I'll just say a few words about Cecily and Andy. Cecily is a social justice organizer, advocate for prison reform, and a graduate of the New School for Social Research, where she received her Master of Arts degree in Liberal Studies in 2015. While a student at the New School, Cecily was an active member of the Student Senate and was very involved in student activities. About her now just released book, Hamilton College history professor Maurice Iserman said that, and I quote Professor Iserman here, "Cecily McMillan's memoir of her time as an Occupy activist and as a political prisoner will prove to be the coming of age in Mississippi story for the millennial generation." That's a big mantle to hold. So congratulations for that, Cecily. Tonight, our panel moderator is Andy Stepanian, who began his activism as an adolescent, campaigning for environmental and social justice issues. Andy's lifelong activism resulted later in his conviction and then sentencing to 3 years in federal prison for protesting of animal testing. Today, Andy serves as a creative director at Balestra Media, and he's co-founder of the Sparrow Project, a PR and creative direction consultancy that supports grassroots activism, prison and prison reform, and other social justice efforts. So now let me turn the mic over to Andy, who will introduce our distinguished panel.
I everyone doing? Over there is Faye Mualimm-ak, and he is an organizer with the Campaign to End the New Jim Crow and the co-founder of the Incarcerated Nation group. Over here, and I wish you guys were kind of up here this way, but there's a process. Is J. Love Calderon. She's an activist, an author, a producer, director, and social impact strategist who has spent over two decades working on issues of social justice, race, and gender. J. Love is the co-founder and CEO of J. Love and M1 Productions and has served as the national leadership team of Showing Up for Racial Justice for the past 5 years. I'm honored to also introduce Hernan Caravante. Hernan is a program analyst for the Vera Institute for Justice, where he works on improving conditions of confinement, including efforts to support the incorporation of youth voices in facility-based and statewide juvenile justice policy reform. So welcome, Hernan. And then Renee Feltz. Renee Feltz is an award-winning journalist who covers criminal justice and immigration for The Guardian and is a correspondent for Democracy Now!, where she was senior producer. Before coming to New York, she co-founded and directed the local news department at a Pacifica radio station, KPFT-FM, in Houston, where she interviewed more than 20 men and women on death row. Tonight's panel is going to be interesting. It's going to tackle intersections of privilege and fighting for racial and social justice. There may be moments that are uncomfortable. There may be moments that we have to work through as a group. There may be moments where we don't agree with one another, but I think that everyone who's on this panel brings something unique to this conversation, and I'd like to open up the end of this panel for, you know, a lively discussion around these issues because they're exceptionally important. So I'd like to invite the panel to join me on the stage here, and we'll get to our conversation. Five. Yes. We've known each other for a few years. Recently, I read a debate online debating the concept of allyship versus being an accomplice and having solidarity in the trenches. Can you tell me a little bit about this breakdown between being an ally and being an accomplice and how folks that are in this room can best support some of the issues that you work on?
Yeah. First, I would like to start by saying an ally is someone who's a side by side by you, right? But in the movement, ally has been in a sort of remedial support. In other words, those directly impacted aren't supported in leadership, but they're tokenized to say, hey, come to this event, sit on this panel, and then we're gonna tell you what the problem is, right? In America, we have to understand that the only constitutional law that supports incarceration is the furtherance of slavery, right? The 13th Amendment states that you are a slave once you're incarcerated. So by listening to the words of ex-slaves and the leadership of ex-slaves, those who have directly impacted it, is what being an accomplice is, because you're involved with everything that they're doing. There's no reason why people who are directly impacted, and a lot are here today, are sort of subservient to the system, right? So you have an organization and you just want a panelist who's directly impacted, let him speak for like 10 minutes of a problem that's been his life, right? And it led to a system of what we call trauma porn, where people get excited about this issue, right? They give you a little honorarium and that's it, right? Whereas an accomplice is, we're involved every day. We're involved with it. You are a part of my life, but you're a part of this movement. And it led to actually a conversation where a lot of academics were saying, well, I studied this for 20 years. Okay, but give you a perfect example. This comrade right here lived it all of his life, right? So what's the difference in leadership? What gives you the qualifications when this man has been through it since he was a child and on Rikers itself? Why is he struggling, but multi-million organizations are making money off of these quote-unquote solutions, right? So it should be a conversation of what do you see as important because you've been through it. So the privilege of being able to do things and have the resources is a complication, right? and we struggle every day. I am a poor advocate and probably do more with no money than most people do with money. But people don't support us in leadership. And I think that it's a difference. So being an accomplice is you're involved in every way. You're involved with the movement, not in a leadership position. I do not need white people telling me, this is the problem and this is how you're gonna solve it, and you just play this little part of the solution, right? This is the prison industrial complex where products are made. How many people have Levi's in their house? Victoria's Secret, Walmart, Kmart, BP, right? All of these things are made in prison. When we feel proud that we're buying the made in the USA just so we can sit on the toilet and send somebody a crazy picture, right? Those computer motherboards are made in prison, right? Starbucks, they're printed in prison, right? McDonald's, made in prison, right? All of these products that have supported America is a continuous of slavery. And as we've done outreach and we've worked and it actually ran down on organizations like Third Generation that sells all the products to JCPenney, we've noticed that they said, well, the governor said we couldn't have a warehouse unless it was in the prison. You know, brave friends like my friend Piper Kerman has put that into her series. And that's an actual fact. How did we know that? Well, the ACLU had a report from two people who were put in solitary because they were locked up for sending underwear home, because they were cutting off the Made in Malaysia labels. You see, when they had their establishment, the governor said, well, we'll cut off all the stuff you have now and put the Made in USA labels on all of those. Don't worry about it. We got slaves to do that. I mean, sorry, we have people to do that. We're going to give them 16 cents an hour. So when you're shopping these products, you're supporting the system. And I think that that awareness happens because that means that you are also directly impacted. You're paying for it, right?
I mean, it's,
sorry, that was a little lengthy.
No, I mean, it's true. I think that just to build off that really quick, it takes more than just listening. And then once someone who has privilege starts to activate around an issue, you know, can you highlight when someone may all of a sudden become problematic? And I do want to move to J-Love, but I mean, yeah, if you can.
No, I'm sorry, what was that again?
I mean, like, here's an example, right? Let's say I hear something that you had to say today and I got really impassioned about it, and all of a sudden I take what resources are available to me and I run with it. And next thing I know, my bravado or my male white privilege or my cis privilege or anything else like that allows me to run out the gates and do certain things, and next thing I know, I'm not really listening anymore. I'm leading. What would you say to folks that end up in that position of no ill intent?
If you want to support those directly impacted in leadership. And I just came from a conference in California with over 600, all the political prisoners in this country were there, and literally 600 organizations nationally, all under one umbrella. I mean, you can donate resources, but also help us that's on the ground supporting the families. And those are organizations who have people directly impacted in leadership. And most of us have our own nonprofits and have our own fundraising system. But you'll give to the bigger organizations who say that they're doing the work, right? They're not actually directly working in the impacted communities, right?
You know, when we talk about directly impacted communities, you know, maybe J-Love, you can jump in here. You've been touched in your own life by individuals who have been impacted by the system. You know, how did that affect you personally, and how did that inform some of the activism that you're doing now?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Let's give it up to five, though. That was beautiful. Thank you for sharing the truth. Peace, everyone. My name's Jay Love. I am a white woman, and I like to let people know that because my husband's Dominican, so my last name is Calderon. And so sometimes people think that I'm Latina, and I think it's important because we live in a racist society that we start with our identities. Someday that won't be the case, but today it really is. And I come here as a white woman, a straight white woman, in this body, on this planet, and I have a purpose, and my purpose is about truth and love and freedom and liberation for all people on the planet. And I can't change the fact that I'm a white woman, but I can do something about it every single day to change the injustice that's happening to people of color. And I believe that that is my job as a white person. And the reason why I had these, it's so interesting. I believe the universe put me here because when I was young, the people that were closest to me got locked up and incarcerated and taken away from me. And I was young and dumb and ignorant, you know, 12, 13, 14 years old. And I come from Denver, Colorado. That's my hometown. What I knew was that people that I loved were torn away from me, and we were all participating in the same types of things, and they got punished and I did not. And that's what I understood. I didn't understand anything else. But what led me to find out why was because the simple thing of love. People that I cared about were gone, and gone for 16, 18 years. And I needed to understand why, because I was heartbroken. And so what happened for me is I started to learn about white supremacy, I started to learn about racism, and I started to learn about my skin privilege, my unearned privilege, which is why I did some of the crime, but I didn't do the time. And that started me on a journey of becoming the best that I could be as a white woman standing up for racial justice. And that's a little bit about why I'm here today. So thank you for listening, and I look forward to dialoguing with y'all.
Thank you for that, J-Love. I'm gonna move along to Cecily. You know, you went from being an occupier to being incarcerated yourself. And can you tell us a little bit about that journey and the turn you took once incarcerated, how your activism took a new shape, and how you took your time in the Rose M. Singer Center to advocate for those women back at Rosie. Can you let us know a little bit about that?
Yeah. I was one of 7,000 approximately arrests made throughout the duration of Occupy Wall Street. I guess it was two of those, technically. Because the officers, the initial officer sexually assaulted me, and then half a dozen officers responded in retaliation, thinking that I had assaulted him. They kicked and beat me into a brain-damaging seizure and let me seize for several minutes on end as they turned paramedics away. And I was then held in the hospital for 40 hours. Back and forth through incarceration. I did not know what had happened to me, so when I ended up back in jail, the women told me that I needed to go back in and that I had had a seizure, that if I hadn't gotten an MRI, I could have a brain bleed or something worse. During that time, I was treated like anybody who goes into a hospital in handcuffs. I was not seen as a human being, I was seen as a criminal. The officer would talk to the doctor outside, and then, is that better? Okay. And then no doctor treated me for 40 hours. There was no MRI, there was no exams. I'm assuming that the doctors had told them that I was wasted. I ended up in a storage closet, handcuffed hands and feet, spread eagle as officers came in for hour after hour. Talking about my occupussy and how I needed a good hard fuck. And when I emerged, I was convicted of felony assault of an officer for an incident that not only did I not commit, but that I don't have any memory of because it was not intentional. Mm-hmm. I was grabbed by an officer from behind at the waist here in a seatbelt grab motion. And as a trained nonviolent activist, I put my hand on top of his hand. And if you can imagine being kids, stop hitting yourself. His hand tearing across my body pulled my elbow back. And as I'm about to elbow Renee here, he got elbowed in the face. So just like you don't remember slamming your own face into a steering wheel when you get into a wreck, I had no recollection of that. I guess by the end of it, I ended up on a 4-week-long trial, and by ended up, I mean I had the privilege. To me, playing out was never a question. In the way that I grew up, Mexican in an all-white town, and poor and in transitional homelessness, really the only thing that you have left is your dignity. And it's not for sale. So I wasn't going to say that I assaulted an officer who sexually assaulted me, and in that case, my first time I was ever sexually assaulted. And I didn't think of it as courage or brave or that I was being a martyr of any sort. It's just why would you say that you did something you didn't do when you look like how I look, and when you have the privilege of exposing a justice system for its unjust tactics. My brother having been to prison, and my mother and my father both being felons. So I went through the trial and put on the show, put on the heels, the Manolos and the pearls and the sorority pen, and walked in every day and tried to have no emotions about what was happening. And then I took the stand, and I was remanded to Rikers without bail. And just to give you an understanding of that, like, the Charleston shooter got $1 million bail on his weapons charge. So I became, in Rikers to the guards, America's most wanted, that's what they call me, AMW. And to the prisoners, how many officers did you kill? Because nobody believed that I had just elbowed an officer. And yeah, well, in there, I guess, just to like really wrap it up, because I see Andy's gazing stares over there. I was in with women who, for the first time, identified with me as Latina. They said that, well, you're not white, because if you were white, you wouldn't be in here. And that's true. There's like five women that were white passing, and they were all half Latina when I was in there. I mean, it's racial genocide. It's absolutely a precursor to what we think of when we think about the Holocaust. I mean, there's not even white guards in there, really. That's an anomaly. That's a place where souls go to die. And I watched people die as well. A woman for 12 hours go into organ failure. I, you know, watched a woman miscarry, this bloody little mess seeping out of her body as she called on God and guards to help and was heard by no one. I had a piece of my vagina cut out of me on a biopsy claim because I was trying to get birth control that was, quote, abnormal, the depot shot, and I needed birth control because it was a really real threat that you could get raped in Rikers, and if I'm gonna get raped, then okay, but I don't wanna get pregnant. And I pulled out somebody's tooth because they waited for 6 months to get in to see a doctor and nobody took their tooth out. I lived with people who had very serious paranoid schizophrenia, and I could keep going on this, but it's what Five said. It's trauma porn. And when I got out and I realized that that's all that society wanted to hear, trauma porn, and they wanted to hear about whether or not I was in jail with murderers, alleged murderers, yes. And also there's a lot of good reasons to kill someone when you don't have the money to buy space for sanity, for health, for dignity, when you're living in a house that's 12 deep, with men that have been castrated by a society that take your body. There's not a single woman in there that had not been raped. Not a single woman that I met. I mean, yeah, the ability to not be a criminal is the ability to buy that right. And I wrote the book because people kept wanting the story, the lifetime story. So I gave them the story, and the end of the story is that I met the most incredible women I've ever met in my life, despite anything. If you think of everything that you have in your home, Q-tips, Modest Mouse, iPods, nail clippers, clothes. You don't get clothes when you go into Rikers. Like, you're stuck with whatever you come in wearing. Your underwear, you're wearing that now for the next up to 5 years of your life if you don't have family to give you underwear, except for the fact that these women do what women do. They take care of each other, they do care packages, they support each other. And in a world in which women are not structured against each other but allowed to live in commune, God, these women were inspired and inspiring. Their existence is resistance. Everybody tells them, can you die already? And they thrive as the best human beings I've ever met in my life. They keep humanity alive because that is what they have, their dignity. And they do that day in and day out for not only themselves inside and not only for people like me, even me, but they sustain whole communities on the outside from a telephone without money. Can you imagine if we were half the organizers that they are? And so this book is for them.
You know, I think I want to revisit some of the women at the Rose M. Singer Center, but you brought up a really important point, which was that society has a tendency to relegate prisoners to the worst of the worst, or, you know, not members of society, or somehow inhuman. And What you saw in there was the epitome of humanity. You know, some of this, I guess, you know, when you crush coal hard enough, you get diamonds. You see the best in people under those circumstances. Hernan, for as much as you're willing to talk about it, you know, you went to jail as a minor. You spent several years incarcerated. There was a different set of expectations on you because of your heritage. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience and kind of the trajectory that you went from being incarcerated as a young person to now working in policy?
So, disclaimer, much of what I say is very much on my personal narrative. My title there is for the Vere Institute, but today I'm more or less Hernan. And that's an important distinction I'll probably touch more upon and go more into that as I keep talking. But I went into the justice system, and I'm very open about my background. I went into the justice system for the crime of attempted murder. I went into the justice system a gang member. I went into the justice system an impulsive teenager who had never had an opportunity to deal with none of his issues while in the community, because I came from an undocumented family. Both my parents are undocumented. And because the fear that they had of systems was a fear that I grew up around. And so I never sought out help because of having that fear. When I entered the justice system, I entered it very naive. I did not know what exactly I was getting myself into as I was committing acts of violence in the community. I did not know what I was working myself into as I continuously engage in drugs and meeting people to cause them some type of harm. And so while I was in the system, I was very much a product of my environment in the community. But the environment that I witnessed while I was in a secure detention facility was that of guards versus the people who are locked up. In my case, it was always us versus them. It was always the guards versus the youth. It was always, I either had to be with my peers or I had to be with the guards. And I sort of had to take a step back every time, because when I went into the system, I went in there having, you know, a daughter on the way. I went in there having never held a job. I went in there with very little supports. And so when I was there, I was very much on my own. My parents, again, being undocumented, didn't know the system language. I was just learning the system language. I grew up in the system and developed the skills and things that I needed in the system, not because the system allowed me to do that, but because people individually took their time to actually speak to me. And there were people who were able to look beyond my immediate offense and who were able to see me no longer as a criminal or as a gang member or as a Latino who, quote unquote, could very easily say, you know, I was always getting the joke from staff of like, so when's the next hit that the cartel is going to do or something like that, just because I was Mexican, which was just a joke of sorts. I heard from staff over and over, you know, I'm here because you make my paycheck every 2 weeks, kid. I'm not here for you. I'm here because of the money, for the benefits, and ultimately you pay for my son or daughter's school. And so it was dehumanizing over and over to be in those circumstances and to be in an environment where I could be sitting next to Andy here and all of a sudden we're watching TV and you're very much, it's just another day going by in a facility and I'm talking to you about getting a visit the next day and 5 seconds later, you're getting jumped by other people on the unit and you're right next to me. I'm not the target, so I'm pretty much just witnessing what is going on. And staff sort of intervening, not through trying to figure out what happened, but very much on restraining you, giving you rug burns by throwing you to the ground, possibly breaking an arm if you're thrown down in an incorrect way. And then my peers also swinging at staff, spitting on staff. So it was a very violent environment. And to maintain an identity of wanting to be a college student, wanting to do right in that system, in that setting, was very hard. And I continuously got the thing from my peers of, you know, you're a pet for the guards and you're the person who, if anything went wrong in the unit where the staff knew that it was gonna go wrong, I was the rat because I try to do good. And ultimately I was always stuck in that conflict. I either was with my peers or I was stuck with the staff. I couldn't balance out. There was always a very clear line where I couldn't do good because I would be against my peers, and I couldn't really try to stick to that image and be with my peers because then the staff would think that I was just playing the fence. So I did a lot of faking it to make it while I was in the system. And what I ended up doing was try to get as busy as possible while I was there. GED, custodian maintenance, kitchen, library. I try to stay away from my unit and from groups of staff all the time. And by the time I actually began to turn my life around, I began to embrace this identity of wanting to be a college student, wanting to be a leader. And all of those things happened while I was continuously quitting on myself and quitting on the people around me, including my family in the community, including my peers in the system. I was always stuck in this identity crisis throughout the time that I was there. And to this day, I can say that I am continuously struggling with that identity. Even now, as I speak about that experience, I'm continuously thinking about who am I in the context of the conversation? Am I the young person who was a gangbanger and was, again, involved in such other atrocious acts that I never got caught for? Or am I now the college student and the advocate and the person working on policy at the Vere Institute of Justice? And so there's always this dynamic that stems from the fact that in the system, I didn't have a clear identity. And to this day, I'm still building that identity because of the fact that the system sort of promotes this idea that I had to be a certain way. And if I didn't fit that description of being negative, gang affiliated, and all these other roles, that I was then not someone that I was supposed to be. And so that's what I always felt. And that's what my peers around me felt. And mind you, the units everywhere in that facility, where it was over 150 young men, looked like me, had similar stories like me, black, brown. If you saw a white kid in the facility, it was in the mental health unit. It was probably five of them. But they were all in the mental health unit. And everyone else was in the general population. And so just thinking about the fact that the dynamics there, and my facility was in upstate New York, in Claverack, New York. And most of the staff there, again, knew each other. Families literally made the livelihood out of working in these facilities and would constantly say how much the economy in the upstate sort of dynamic was based off of the infrastructure that these facilities offered. So just keeping that in mind as we're thinking about these discussions and the fact that there are so many other young men, including, you know, some who I currently talk to and some of whom are still going through the justice system, who didn't get that many opportunities and who weren't offered an opportunity to really manifest themselves into something that I have become. And that was truly through opportunity and individual assistance, not through the way that the system was actually created to function.
You know, identity is definitely something that gets lost within the system. I know that my identity was 2639-9050. And it's been 7 years since I was called 2639-9050, but I remember it like better than my social security number.
And 310-1400-431.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm going to break moderator duty for 1 second because between something that Cecily said, and I remember the story that we were working on for The Intercept regarding that woman who had passed. You know, I was good friends. I never told you this, Cecily, and for transparency purposes, I helped Cecily do some press releases and PR work while she was going through her trial, making sure the media was reporting on it and such. During that time, I tried to do my best to support Cecily, and part of that was withholding certain things from her. And I never told you about one of my own experiences, which was that my close friend, his name is Wilgins Eugene, died of appendicitis in my unit. And we worked for about 2 weeks to get him medical attention. At the end, we saw him get dragged out when we finally convinced them that it wasn't a batch of bad hooch. When he didn't drink, they just refused to believe that this young man of color wasn't drinking and partying the night before, and that's why he was throwing up. But he got so sick that he couldn't walk anymore. We convinced a few guards, and it happened to be the Odinists, the white supremacists, to help us, to get the guard's attention. And they brought him down to the medical unit. By the time they put him on a gurney, he died in front of the visitors at the visiting hall as they were trying to get him out of the building to get him to a hospital. And the way that they treated the visitors, again, was like stripping him of their identity, because now you have people and their families that were coming to visit them, their protocol was to make everybody, including the children, face the wall so they wouldn't see this person convulsing and dying in front of them. And I think about that a lot. You know, I'm trying not to get emotional while I'm up here, that you had talked about the women at the Rose M. Singer Center, and we are going to revisit some of that about showing solidarity. But I think that the first thing that we need to do when we think about incarcerated people is that they're people. You know, they're people. And Wilgins Eugene was his name. It wasn't a series of 11 digits. His name was Wilgins Eugene. He was from Trinidad, and I worked with him in the GED department. He had just finished his associate's degree from the State University in North Carolina, and he was excited to finish the rest of schooling once he came home. He was scheduled for release a year and a half from the time that he died. Renee, you've covered a lot of these bleak stories in great detail, better than any of us ever could when it comes to writing. You've won awards for it. Can you tell me a little bit about, or tell us a little bit about how you ended up at KPFT and some of the events that led up to you working there and some of the experiences that you had?
Well, certainly, Andy, and thanks again for having me on the panel, and it's really great to be up here with Cecily. Thank you for writing the book, and thank you for getting this conversation started. It's a conversation that's ongoing, and I'm always happy to be part of it. As you were describing what happened to you with your arrest, I know there is some grainy video, and I just have to put in a plug for Democracy Now! Cecily was on the show and raised some of the points that she's now exploring in the book, so if you want to watch some of what happened to her and her discussing it, you can go to our website, democracynow.org. I also wanted to just make a quick note also about what you're describing and remind us that Rikers is pretrial detention generally. People aren't even convicted and going through what you described. So how did I get to KPFT, which is a Pacifica radio station in Houston, Texas? So this is just a little bit of a personal narrative of my own that I thought I would share as perhaps a way to demonstrate common experiences that you might have that would lead you on a similar path. So I was a military brat. I grew up all over the world, and I ended up for my last 2 years of high school in Texas. And Texas, as we know, is infamous for executions, still is. But I didn't grow up around it, so it wasn't normalized for me. It was shocking still. And I was aware of it. I was shocked by it, but I wasn't really active around it. This was back in the late 90s. And I got a little bit into activism around police brutality issues. And I started getting into organizing around the case of Mumia Abu-Jamal. Raise your hand if you know who Mumia is. All right. So, you know, I was organizing around Mumia. We had a little group called Houstonians United for Mumia, HUM. And like many of you here, probably, you know, part of the way we were politicized as well was through music and punk rock. And we organized benefit shows. And I organized a benefit show at a community center called SHAPE. It's in Third Ward in Houston. It calls for, stands for self-help for African American people through education. I think that's what it stands for, yes. And it was founded by former Black Panthers in Houston, who this grew out of their breakfast program. And, you know, after I did the benefit show there, I thought, well, let me try to stick around here. This is a great space. I met great people, and I wanted to give back a little. So I got involved in the after-school program, and that shaped some of my awareness of maybe what you would describe as experiences that I wouldn't have had otherwise, being in this African-American community center in Houston. So moving right along, I got involved in some other activism when someone approached me and said, you know, Mumia's on death row, but so are a lot of people in Texas. Why don't you take a look at some of that? So I got involved in Texas execution organizing. And in 2000, when George W. Bush was our governor and running for president in Texas, we organized a massive demonstration in Huntsville against the execution of Shaka Sankofa, otherwise known as Gary Graham. And he had always maintained his innocence while he had been convicted of other crimes. There was no real eyewitnesses of this murder, and it was really questionable whether or not he had actually committed murder. He was just sort of being tarred and feathered for his other crimes, and they pin this on him. So that's not good enough to execute generally, but it is in Texas, and they proceeded with this execution. And because George Bush was running for president, there was a whole wall of cameras out there in Huntsville, and Huntsville had never really seen a demonstration like this before. So I was part of a group that got arrested at the protest, eight of us, and we became known as the Huntsville Eight. You know, it wasn't just to get arrested, but it was trying to, you know, raise the profile of this execution and make a point. So we had a two-year-long strung-out trial with a judge that looked like Colonel Sanders in Huntsville, Texas. We used a necessity defense. We did not succeed. I got convicted of criminal trespass. It's a common conviction these days. My boss, Amy Goodman, has got a warrant out for criminal trespass. And we had community service as our punishment, and I asked that my community service be at KPFT in Houston. And so I went down to the radio station, and I got more involved as a volunteer, and I helped to found a news department. There had been a news department in the past. If you know about Pacifica, it's been through some up and downs. And so we did city, state, regional, and won awards. A lot of people appreciated the news. But one thing I took advantage of was my press pass. And I took that press pass, and I went back up to the same place where I got arrested protesting for executions. And I did interviews. And just to clarify, the interviews I also did were in Livingston, Texas, not in Huntsville, because that's where executions happened in Huntsville, but the actual death row is in Livingston, Texas, at the Polensky unit. I also went up to Gatesville to talk to women on death row. There's a bunch of them. And one of them I interviewed twice, Frances Newton. There was sort of a case where she was accused of killing her husband. And I won't get into all the details, but and then she had a reprieve, and then eventually she was executed again. So I had the opportunity to interview her twice. She really made a big impression on me. She left behind three kids. And, you know, so my experience was one in which the state tried to punish me for certain behavior, and I turned that into an opportunity to explore, you know, an avenue to take advantage of my skills for storytelling and reporting and take advantage of my position to get off, you know, with some community service and to go back in and do these interviews. And a couple quick points, you know, as we can tell here from this panel, you know, folks that are behind bars have a lot of knowledge about what's going on back there, and it's really great to talk to them when you're doing the reporting about executions or about the death penalty in Texas. They have some inside knowledge. And also you just see a lot, as you guys described, from going in there, whether it's a visitor or as a journalist. And you know, it was really important to me, and I'm proud of this, that I was creative about actually hearing their voices. So I worked at a radio station. And so at first you go in there, when you look through the glass to do an interview, you're talking on a handset. And you have to get these alligator clips and rig it all up, and you sound like you're talking to someone on the phone, even though you just drove 2 hours to get there and went through a whole rigmarole to get inside. And you still sound like you're on the phone when you play the tape. So anyway, you know, for other journalists in the room here, it's an interesting technique. You can bring a wireless lavalier with you. And if you're friendly, you know, maybe you can get a guard to put the wireless lav on the person behind the glass. And all of a sudden, when people in the real world outside behind, you know, they hear voice of an individual, not someone over the phone. And eventually got into doing some more video there. And, you know, the thing I would just say is, I learned so much from listening to folks behind bars, and then once they're out, I've continued to rely on formerly incarcerated people as my sources predominantly, especially when I'm shaping a story. And just real quick, you know, I brought some papers up here, and I wanted to plug a story I did about a group called Release Aging People from Prison, RAP, which I know Five knows. And just very briefly, you know, when you take a perspective of the organizers in RAP, who are formerly incarcerated folks that are working to get elderly people out of prison despite the intransigent of the New York State Parole Board, the story is told differently. So if you read the New York Times editorial, you'll hear about a judge who found the state parole board in contempt of court. Well, the judge didn't just come up with that on her own. She had a case brought before her, and that case was generated by formerly incarcerated people helping people still behind bars to put these cases out. So anyway, when you look at your sources, I think it can shape the reporting that we do. So that's a little bit of how I got to KPFT. And you know, the reporting that I did at KPFT around executions helped me a lot when I came up here to New York, and Amy was open-minded to bringing our live broadcast down to the execution of Troy Davis, which was right before Occupy really took off, and we saw the synergy between those movements. So you never know what's going to happen. You always want to, you know, if you're a protester, organizer, do that. But, you know, if you want to pursue a different path, there's still ways to achieve, you know, our goals, you know, wherever we find ourselves. And sorry to ramble there at the end, but that's a little bit about how I ended up at KPFT, Andy.
Thank you, Renee. Regarding mobilizing ourselves, so, like, and this is a bit of our second half of this conversation, as opposed to just kind of setting the stage and telling personal stories. I just wanted to check with Anne, are we able to cut to questions at 8:30, and do we have to be out of this space at 8:30?
I think we're good until 8:30. Do you think you guys will have questions for the panelists?
I'm sure there will be some questions. I want to make sure I create time for that. Okay, so we're going to kind of trudge through the mobilizing part and then hopefully continue that conversation with you and mobilize together. So I'm going to go briefly to J-Love. You've worked with showing up for racial justice. I think there is definitely a disconnect between just posting on Facebook the next Mike Brown video or the next kind of police murder porn or whatever you want to call it, and actually showing up and putting your body in harm's way and doing something that interrupts a system that is potentially structurally racist or structurally biased. So can you tell us a little bit about showing up?
How many people here have heard of showing up for racial justice or SURGE? Beautiful. Okay, cool. So we're talking a little bit about clicktivism, right? Do people know about clicktivism? Like, I liked it. I shared it. Do y'all know about clicktivism? Okay, that's just like basically there's a lot of people who feel like they're activists because on social media they'll like or share something. So we're calling that clicktivism. And we're saying like, yo, like online, offline organizing is super important. So basically showing up for racial justice is white people organizing white people for racial justice. And we started in 2009, and our goal is really to make sure that white people have many pathways to organize, no matter where they see themselves. There's a lot of times when activism is happening where it's targeted to other activists, and we're looking for everyday white folk who understand that shit is fucked up and that things have to change. And people who understand that they don't have to be activists and know every single new term in order to get down and dirty and do some work. Activism, activate, right? Be active. And so we are really asking white folks to stand up and to be able to acknowledge that we have unearned privilege and to go the step beyond. Because right now it's kind of cool to say, yeah, I have white privilege. That's kind of the norm now. What are you doing about it? And how can we join forces so that we can normalize white people saying we cannot continue to exist when black and brown people are persecuted for the color of their skin? Are y'all down with me? Are you guys cool with that? Okay, so that's what we're about, and we're about mobilizing people for action. We're about direct action when we can. We're about using all the tools of storytelling, activism, anything that we can to get people aware and activated to go out and do something. We now have 96,000 members. We went from 10 chapters to 150 chapters in 5 years. And we are really just asking y'all to stand up and join with us and normalize white people saying that enough is enough. So that's a little bit about SURGE. I hope everybody joins SURGE and becomes a member. And let's really have that conversation and be like, what can you do in your everyday life? We're not asking you to, you know, spend all of a sudden 8 hours a day, but what can you do? What's one thing you can do? What's something that you can get other people involved in that feels good and right for you to start pushing this agenda of racial justice? So that's what we're about, and I hope people will get down with us.
Yeah, you know, I do want to piggyback on that. I was in Ferguson for a few months, and I noticed that a lot of foundations will parachute into town to be part of the cause célèbre of that moment. Right? And there's a difference between recognizing the fact that sometimes people on the ground are organized in their own capacities, and they may not have access to the media coverage and other things that we're used to seeing, or the foundation funding, or the nice shirts or banners or whatever else. And so I want to highlight some of Five's work. Recently, there was a meeting where over 600 individuals representing their own projects, all of those 600 individuals were formerly incarcerated themselves. We're mobilizing together in a massive coalition. And Five, some of your work with the campaign to end the new Jim Crow, I think there are ways that people can tap in. It's not that Kellogg, or I said I wouldn't put anyone on blast. It's not like it's not like any particular foundation needs to lead on this issue. I really shouldn't have done that. Here goes the next grant. But any particular foundation on any issue needs to lead on this, because there are leaders mobilizing as we speak. And there are ways that we can tap in and that folks with privilege could tap in and say, okay, put me to work. So can you tell this room about how you can be put to work?
Yes, definitely. I have some material up there around one of the voting rights campaigns that we're doing with the campaign and Jim Crow. But what the founders and what the elders had did was created a project called Incarcerated Nation Corp, which is everyone working collectively together. And it was founded by Joseph Jazz Hayden, Albert Woodfox, and Robert King, even though Albert was still inside through letters. And also through Larry White, who also works with AFSC and has a project called Hope Lives for Lifers. So it's about 26 nonprofit projects that all work together, but all in leadership, and in every one of those projects, in leadership, and even down to the committees, it is people directly impacted. And we have funders saying, well, we never funded a group of just all people directly impacted, so, you know. Do you have anybody there with degrees? Like, oh yeah, everybody has degrees and masters and, you know, and all of those, and it's still not a reason, right? But you don't. It's not about the academia that's stopping it. It's because they don't want to support those directly impacted. You know, we do have a voting campaign, but take the time to speak to that. The organization that one of our projects, and when we started the release of aging people in prison, it was because we wanted to put those with most directly impacted. There's a man over here right now. I'm about to put you on blast, Abdul Rahman, who came with me as well. He's a member and an organizer with RAP. This man just did over 45 years incarcerated, and when they come home, they're willing to do this work. So what is our excuse, right? The other thing is, like, when Albert Woodfox came home after doing over 45 years in solitary alone, he came right to my office. I was shocked, opened the door like, oh my God, my uncle's here. Like, and he's like, and I'm thinking, he's telling me that he's gonna go to Hawaii and live the rest of his life. He's like, no, let's get to work. Like I told you, when I come home, I'm on your board, let's get to this. Have you done this work on behalf, but also to elevate my issues nationally? That's how I got home. That's how Hooks got home. I'm sorry, that's how Herman Wallace got home. And these are our elders, and we need help as well, but we don't need to be allies where you're helping me and sort of me, but also assisting and stand by us, you know? And support those directly impacted financially, because giving to the big organizations and they're litigating and breaking and creating rules that is only gonna strengthen the system. See, I'm an abolitionist and I believe in brick by brick, so if I do a piece of legislation and tomorrow I'm coming back like, oh, I'm shortening it again and then again and again, and then we're all Southside. And then we also produce services, bus trips for families, food pantries. We have a huge array of needs, but we also do it collectively. So it's not too hard to support those campaigns.
That's amazing.
And just really quick, you know, we live in a country where two out of every five black individuals, people of color, are incarcerated on a regular basis. We're murdered every day on the screen and on TV. We also live in a country where we have about 320 million Americans, right? So 80 million Americans are disenfranchised, and just because they have been disenfranchised from employment, are previously incarcerated. Another 20 million from housing. That's 100 million previously incarcerated people that all cannot vote, all cannot have citizenship, all do not have the vital resources even to live when they come out. So returning citizens are the most marginalized population in this planet and still struggle years after years after years after years. I've been doing this work for about 5 years now since I've been home, and I don't get paid for this. I do not get a check. I live in a studio with three kids and I struggle, right? My son does this work. He doesn't get paid for this. We all are struggling, but to be an ally, I don't need you to tell me I understand it. I need you out there and I need you to help. Because right now, in other countries like Germany, they teach about the Holocaust every day in school. In front of your house, there's plaques of the people that they drove out of their house and killed them, right? In Auschwitz itself, it's still open so that you can see it, right? Because you can't get past it if you don't talk about it. So we have to have these comfortable spaces about race. We have to take suggestions and also follow leadership of those directly impacted. So I invite you to even go over there and speak to this man. Talk to this brother right here. Talk to other people who are directly impacted, who are doing this work every day by themselves. And it's hard, right? But it's not hard together, because we're all working for the same cause, which is a better way of life and a better way in this world, because we're in this country together. And some people ask about private prisons. It's a very small part of it. But we all buy those products, you know? We're now developing our own, we have a website as well. We're revamping it. I would love anybody from Parsons to help, please. New schools to help. But this is also gonna highlight all of the materials and items that you buy, and you might be shocked when you visit that, because your closet represents your silent support of the system. And just by boycotting at it, saying, I don't believe in Made in the USA. If somebody's making 16 cents an hour, why am I paying $42 for this panty set, right? So we have to understand that we have responsibility, right? And just really quick also, people always ask me, because I live with mental health and I suffer from schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, right? I also work on a mayor's behalf task force, which I'm not even gonna talk about that. But we wonder why so many people with mental illness are incarcerated. Well, in the 80s when Reagan cut community-based funding, right? Those people were on the street. And remember, we had great Commissioner Bratton before he went to California and tore it up and then came back and tore us up again, right? And then we created anti-vagrancy laws, anti-panhandling laws, anti-trespassing laws. We basically made it illegal to be homeless. And then we incarcerated those people. So people who are problematic, who cannot thrive in society, are even more problematic in this microcosmic world of incarceration. And then we only further punish them when returning. So aftercare and reintegration is a process that takes the community. Because guess what? 80% of prisons only come from 3 counties, 7 communities.
You know, I did want to try to get to some of the other folks, but you bring up aftercare and some of the contemporary conversations right now surrounding private prisons and the Federal Bureau of Prisons' decision to remove some of its private prison contracts. You know, we do need to take into consideration that the majority of the aftercare facilities, these are part in custody, part out custody facilities like work release programs, halfway houses, drug release programs, things like that, are being run by the GEO group or by Correctional Corporation of America. These are their cash cows, right? And I recall about a year ago, Renee, a conversation that you had shared with me, and Five, I hate to put you on blast here, but she was talking about how moved she was when you said something in the kitchen, Democracy Now!, I think you guys had a conversation regarding up the street, there is a men's shelter. And folks are coming home with this feeling of being dehumanized for so long that they're thrown into Midtown Manhattan with all its lights, all its bustle. And it's essentially like a child being thrown into the deep end of a pool and they're told to swim. Can you tell us a little bit about that aftercare center and what happened there?
Well, it's actually BRC. It's Bowery Residency. And what they do is they poverty pimp. So Muzzy, who used to run, I'm going to make this try to be as possible, used to work with DHS and HRA. Actually, him, Gordon Campbell, who's on the BOC, and also another guy who's great, Patrick Markey, he runs a coalition for the homeless, which you should all check his website because he has a counter that says, yes, we have 61,000 people homeless every night. So Muzzy didn't get the position he wanted, so he helped to create a sort of system of chronic homelessness. And chronic homelessness is, he said that, okay, John Doe comes in, he goes out, he comes back in, and throughout the course of the year, he's getting the same service. The third time he comes in, like a year later, been in and out the shelter system, he gets the same service as John Doe that comes in that day. So we have to prioritize him because he's chronically homeless and give him immediate housing and immediate services, right? So 95% of charges are willful incarceration, as they call it, because they're all plea bargains. In other words, they say, take this 100 years or do these 5 years, and you'll take that 5 years rather than 100. So that means incarceration is willful in terminology. So if you've been doing 20 years in Attica and you come home, you've been homeless for one day. So he says, don't worry, I'm gonna make $27 a month. I made a website called $27 at the hackathon, sponsored by the school, plug real quick. and it's literally just how much you're paying for every person homeless every night. So he gets that rent money for a year, and then after a year, he does that. But you have people like 2,000 people directly impacted coming directly from Solitary to 42nd Street, Times Square, because that's where the bus drops you off at. You got Spider-Man fighting the Statue of Liberty. You got 20 million commuters. You got 20 million other people that don't even live in this state, right? They don't even live in this country as tourists. And you have to navigate all that, make it to parole, make it home. And then when you get to parole, they tell you, oh, the first rule is you can't be around felons, but I'm going to stick you in this three-quarter house with 3 y'all, triple bunk, and 120 people in the whole space, which you're paying $27 a month for, right? And then you can't leave out to after 9 o'clock. You have to be in before 8 o'clock. You have to have an hour a day of ASAP. You have to have an hour a week of ART, and then somehow find a job because you owe me $30 right now because you have to pay me for parole support, right? And you're doing all of that, and imagine coming home after 4 decades like this man has and the whole world has changed, right? How many people remember 42nd Street in 1968? Different world. This man today on the way here, we almost got into an argument with a woman about trying to give her a seat on the train, right? Because the world is different. So we say these structures of who is helping that reintegration process, right? When he comes home, 1968 to 2016, how much has technology changed? How much has transportation has changed? You see, prison itself is a black hole. You're not getting computers, you don't know nothing. He got an iPhone, took him a week to stop calling me out of his pocket, right? I love him. But this is the problem. There is no intersection because the community walks by these facilities and walk by like this world doesn't exist.
And if I can piggyback on that, I want you to think about all of the laws that you can possibly imagine. And then I want you to think about how many of those you maybe inadvertently or advertently break every single day. If I break a single misdemeanor, any single one misdemeanor sends you back on a bus to Rikers. These women were in there because of violation probation driving across state lines to pick up their children. They were in violation probation because, like me, when my brother got out of jail in Livingston and wanted to help his friends who were still inside, if he were to come live with me, that would be a violation of probation. He has nowhere else to go. And who's going to put up with a felon who's been in jail for 8 years, his entire adult life? Okay, so if you think about that, that's how recidivism happens. If you lose your job, that's violating probation. If you lose your housing, that's violating probation. It doesn't end.
And I think every single case is unique as well. I mean, to my left here, Hernan, you, and I don't mean to like say this in a flippant way, but you're like a superhero in the sense that you kind of overcame all these obstacles that were thrown in front of you, and now you're writing policy. It's an amazing story. It inspires me, and I'm not trying to put pressure on you, because if you want to take a break, you should. But can you tell us a little bit about that trajectory coming home? We all have stories of inadequate aftercare procedures, probation, being on paper, the traps and tripwires set in front of you to have you get sent back. But the fact that you're now at the Vera Institute working on policy, raising up people's voices that are inside the system and helping to codify those into laws that change the system from the inside out.
So, yeah, a lot of the work, I wish I could take a break. And the reason I say that is because for a period of time, I was the poster child for the juvenile justice reform conversations in New York. And a lot of that is because of what Five sort of mentions, this idea that we're not always uplifting the people or the voices of those who've been directly impacted. And a reminder to the audience and to our panel that we have young people who are going through the juvenile justice system, through the child welfare system, through our school system, that are feeders to the larger criminal justice system and the adult systems that currently exist. That not everybody who went through the justice system started there as an adult. Some of them went through other systems that failed them and inevitably ended up in an adult system facing just outrageous periods of time in there. And so a lot of the work that I do is making sure that I'm concentrating my efforts and reminding our government partners and people around the country, including philanthropy, including private organizations, that the voices of those who are formerly the voices of those who've been impacted by the justice system need to be heard, and then they need to be at the table. So no longer just having someone on the menu as an agenda item or a box to check off as like, oh, we have someone who represents this population, check. For me, it's important to uplift the voices and have a young person, for example. And my work focuses heavily on young people because there should be an intergenerational approach to this work, realizing that the experiences of those who are in the adult system differ from those in the juvenile justice system in some ways because of the age difference. But there's still a common purpose, which is the idea that we have a justice system that has failed so many people, young people, families, and ultimately our communities. And so the work at Vera, being able to impact policy now, is one where I have now an opportunity to sit around the people of power, the people who are the change makers, the people who quote unquote run this country, and give them an actual raw story from time to time, or just give them that example from Virginia, that example from Illinois, or that example from LA for the young people that I have stood before who were my peers. I'm only 24, I just turned 24 in May. And again, doing the work that I do in the last 4 years has been a lot of me putting myself out there in a vulnerable situation most oftentimes and making sure that people hear me. And that wasn't a comfortable sort of coming to place. I had to develop the courage to do that. And I also had to force my way into creating spaces for me to be able to do that. And it's sad that I had to create spaces for me to be able to do that. Those spaces should have been in place before I even got out here. And the kind of training that I've received has been very much from trial and error. Getting into trouble for doing some type of advocacy work or breaking some lobbying regulation or doing something that is very, quote unquote, radical, and ultimately learning that it's not radical, it's me advocating for myself. And the fact that I'm advocating for myself and my peers is because we have a broken system. Programs, policies, and practices that currently exist don't work. Who better to inform those policies, programs, and practices than the person who has lived through them, experienced them, and or heard about them? And so that's sort of, again, what the work that I do is really about. And hopefully, again, just a reminder to the audience, we constantly think about how young people can play a huge role in these conversations, where the dominant conversation isn't just the adult justice system. We have a juvenile justice system. Let us not forget that.
So Cecily, your experience, again, was also unique. Obviously, going to jail as an occupier, having not only, you know, your skin privilege come in with you, but also the privilege of being this activist with a movement behind you, kind of turning into a cause celeb on your way in, and then kind of taking this inertia of having Pussy Riot sitting outside the gates of Rikers and the media in droves, like Kim Kardashian is ready to show up or something like that for when you got out. But you leveraged that. You turned that into a moment for the women of the Rose M. Singer Center. And when you exited, you didn't just give a press conference saying it feels good to be out. You read a list of demands. And I think that was something that I found really, really inspiring, is that you were able to work with folks there. You brought your privilege in with you, and then you turned it into something that you could deliver a product out to the rest of the world. So can you explain a little bit how you did that?
I like to say, actually, instead of I turned it into a moment, they turned my release into a moment for me to actually be what it is that I said I was doing at Occupy Wall Street all along, an activist, to actually have an opportunity to be able to listen for those that know their intergenerational circumstance better than I ever could, and to have the opportunity to be a vessel to communicate on behalf of them the breaking of their own chains. And that is what it means to be, in my opinion, mobilizing privilege against the new Jim Crow. Every single person in here, you go to courses, you turn in papers, you do presentations, or you know, you are out here and you can write a letter or you can talk to someone. In there, there's no way to get any recourse for what you're going through every single day. If you die in Rikers and nobody claims your body and nobody is told, nobody is ever told. Nobody sends a letter to your parents. It's not like you have a card that says, here, this is your emergency contact. Like, for one, nobody tells anybody about it. And if nobody somehow magically figures it out, then they cremate your body and then you go into a storage closet. And nobody fucking ever knows what happens to you. So every single person has a voice and you have an opportunity to be a human being and to listen. And in that capacity, right before I left Rikers, I was thinking about that in those terms. Like, how can I use this moment for the women of Rikers? I was sitting there 50 deep in a room with, like, the guards coming in, turtles. Well, turtle means that you have the right gear on. They show up, and if you don't sit down, shut up, put your face down, and don't say anything, then that's considered a tantrum. And if you throw a tantrum, you get beaten until you stop moving. That's how it is. So I'm sitting there trying to like write these lists. And at this point, the women, it's like story time. Like everybody gathers and listens to my speeches. And they tell me that doesn't sound right or don't say that or you know, that doesn't make sense. And I've gone through at this point like 12 drafts. And I'm like, this is shit. I hate this. I'm like, I can't go out there and say this. This doesn't make any sense. I'm not going to do this. And they're like, you have to do this. Like, how will you can't just not do this? And I realized in that moment, like, I'm sitting there with a decision to, like, be heard by the world or not, and I'm, like, having a tantrum about this. Like, how have I been sitting in Rikers Island for 58 days and still having, like, a white bitches be like moment? Like, you know? Okay. Right? Can I get my MacBook? Because I just, like, I need to look up an alternative to this word here. And in the middle of this tantrum, like, I'm, like, bitching about all of these things. Like, how are you supposed to write a fucking speech when you don't have a computer, when I don't know? How am I going to read this? What am I going to do? Read this over the... And I'm, like, having the, like, biggest white wine breakdown on the brink of, I think, having to go back into a world in which this had become my family. This had become my world. And now I was going to have to show up the next day in Calvin Klein and Prada and, like, you know, come out of Rikers, like, activist Barbie status, like, hello, and tell about the circumstance. And along with my bitching, I guess the women of Four East Day had a literal pussy riot. Everybody started bitching, like, one after another. Every single person was sitting there. I mean, it started with sex, that we can't have sex, and that went off on an offshoot of more sex, less jails. That was a chant. And then it turned into an actual one by one. Every woman sitting there is saying, like, what would they do if they were in charge of the policy? What would they change? What would make their lives not only livable at Rikers, but possibly corrective, rehabilitative? And so instead of talking, I started listening, and I started writing down, and I started realizing that this is what privilege is. This is what sharing privilege is literally lending your ear, like shutting the fuck up and letting people who understand the depth of their own oppression better than you ever could did, even if you read Foucault and Freire and Bourdieu or whatever. You know, it's like you have the theory to articulate their experience into a language that people of power will understand. But if you don't understand the basis of their suffering, and it doesn't matter what your suffering is in this circumstance, then you can't do anything for them except for exploit their suffering, commodify their suffering. And so I guess we came up with very, very Heidi demands here. First of all, we demand that we be provided with adequate, safe, and timely health care at all times. Pretty much, we said, can you, like, not kill us, please? And then our next demand was that COs should be required to follow the protocol laid out for them at all times, and that at some point soon, the protocol should be examined to make sure that all the rules and the procedures are in the best interest of the inmates. We also demand that we have a clear and direct means to file a grievance, and that will be taken seriously and examined fully so that officers can be properly disciplined and removed from the area quickly when they abuse or endanger us. So, like, when you're raping us or, like, beating the fuck out of us, like, can we have some recourse, man? And, like, can you also not do that because, like, you're not supposed to? Essentially, can you mind your own rule book? And then finally, we said that we want to be provided with rehabilitative and educational services that will help us to heal our addictions and gain new skills, that will make it easier for us to adjust on the outside and achieve employment when we are released. Inside, all they had was access to GED classes. There is literally not a library in Rosam Singer Center. Occupy Wall Street was their library, for real. They sent in so many books. And I guess when I got out, I read the demands on July 2nd. We aggregated essentially the 63 demands into like a three-prong status that pretty much incorporated them all. And then when nobody responded, we published them in the New York Times. That was July 2nd. That was July 25th. Then when Commissioner Pont still did not take heed of the demands, we brought them to him at Rikers with the New York Times reporters and refused to leave Rikers until we got a meeting with him. And then we brought those demands to the city council. We brought them to, I guess, Tish James, Yadonis Rodriguez, Brad Landers, Inez Barron, and representatives from Lori Kumbo's and Tish James's offices. And we also included in this like round table former prisoners and corrections officers, as well as prison reform experts. And on top of that, we added a couple of more demands for the meeting, which was to discontinue adolescent incarceration at Rikers, restructure mental observation program. People with like mental health disabilities should not be incarcerated due to the fact that you don't want to treat their mental health disabilities, which is a lot of people. I mean, on record, 63% of people in Rikers have a reported mental health disability. Now, like, let's think about how many people have gotten to go sit down with a therapist. And then finally, review and reform current grievance processes for corrections officers. Inadequate structures for COs to report violations and misconduct amongst their coworkers and supervisors perpetuates unsafe practices. So when I went back in to see my friends at Rikers, I was actually quarantined by the female correction officers. He said, you have to help us. The women in Rikers aren't the only, you know, the prisoners aren't the only ones getting raped or sexually assaulted. Our superiors routinely sexually assault us or rape us. And if we say anything, not only are we like not promoted, ultimately then we catch a case. So if you think about one officer who's working up to 16 hours a day in charge of 50 women in four rooms, you've got the bathrooms, the day room, the dormitory, and the kitchen, you have to cut off somebody's windpipe for like 2 minutes and they're dead. So then you get a medical negligence charge. I mean, manslaughter. So if they can put you in there if you don't follow suit, if you report rape. So it's there was no recourse under Seabrook to be able to report any of this. And so I brought that to Commissioner Pont and his deputy commissioner and the spokesperson for Rikers. And they were like, oh my God, this is so great. It's so good to hear from somebody on the inside when we're under federal investigation, but we could really use you on a task force. And I was like, awesome, this is great. And he never called. So, of course. So 2 years and a month later, I showed up at the BOC on Monday and I listened to them talking about all of these same issues. Literally, the entire meeting was about timely medical care. Literally about the rape of women at Rikers. Literally about a grievance structure. Literally about the rules for visitation. Like, I sat there for 2 hours, like, if somebody like me who went through all of, I mean, like, who had all of the possible avenues to make change and sought them out and did that, yes, as a felon without income and like maxed out 2 credit cards doing so. Like if I couldn't do that, if I couldn't make any difference, I mean, who can? Who can be heard? And so I said that to them. And I also said, thanks for calling me back, Commissioner Pont, who was sitting directly behind me. And then I thanked them for responding to the only single thing that I at least can tell that they've done different in the last 2 years, which is to remove adolescent solitary confinement. And then I said, but really, should children be in prison anyhow? But ultimately, I mean, I guess what I will say is what Hernan is doing, what Five is doing, what J-Love is doing, it's not gonna be in the backs of a public figure, a charismatic spokesperson, or somebody who can give a good speech, or somebody who can talk to the New York Times. That's all trauma porn. That's all spectacularizing suffering. Like, people read about the things that I said in the Women of Rikers, or hear me, and they're like, oh my God, I took my daily dose of white guilt today. That is really icky. I feel like I really learned something, and just by hearing, that's activism. People like me alone aren't gonna be able to do anything. People say shut down Rikers, like I hear this all the time, and I look at them like, okay, so we'll do that. It would take like 12 of you to handcuff yourselves together and like block that bridge, you could do that. But the reality is that right now we're not willing to be subject to the same systems that the people we are trying to stand by are on a daily basis. We're not willing to literally put our
bodies between the racist officer wielding a gun and the black boy behind it. This is what knowing your white privilege means. Just saying it is being a cheerleader for it. And also it's nasty, because if you know it, why aren't you doing it? And the amount of people I have to look in the face and say, why aren't more white people like you? I don't have an answer. And I don't think I'm doing anything very special. The point is that you can join these organizations and you can help directly. You can meet directly. You can listen and repeat experiences. You can talk to your friends and your professors at the school. You can talk to President Van Zandt and say, can we have some sort of course here that's taught in the humanities lab by specifically a group of prisoners that get paid, you know, X amount of stipend per week, which would be huge. There's so, we are millennials, man. We invented the internet. Like, our problem solving is like awesome.
I thought that was Al Gore.
Well, but we made it fashionable. So ultimately what I'm saying is, why do we want to shut down Rikers? I just want you to think about that. Like, do you think that all the prisoners just get a ticket home? Like, okay, now that the white people came and shut down your prison, like, you can all go home now. They don't go home. They go to a different jail. This is the only jail in the entire world that people are paying attention to. This is the only place where we have not only the media watching, but the biggest school system in the entire United States here with humanities labs and sociologist students and people reading Foucault and Bourdieu and Freire who can really connect with theoretically the experiences if they go and talk to people that have been incarcerated. You shut down Rikers, I go back home to Atlanta and I have no recourse with the 1 out of 12 Georgians that are currently under the custody of the state, where we have chain gangs still, where people are still hung up by their hands in handcuffs, dislocating their shoulders for hours on end. Rikers isn't the worst. It's the norm. Don't shut it down, change it. Take responsibility, accountability. Be progressive. Put your money where your mouth is.
Yes, give some love.
In terms of moving change and involving the rest of the group in a discussion, Renee, I was going to go to you with a question, but I'm going to try to open it up instead for the rest of the group to have a discussion around this. Just an addendum to some of the bleak and dark things that you said, Cecily. You know, there is one good thing that came out of some of the reporting that had happened, and that in part is due to an amazing journalist named Erica Eckelberger. Erica, in conjunction with the Investigative Fund, the Nation Institute, really followed up on a lot of the leads that you provided and the women at the Rose M. Singer Center provided for her to do that deep dive investigatively into people who were assaulted and sexually abused while in custody in Rikers Island. The trepidation that had happened there eventually led to a private company by the name of Corizon that managed these medical facilities for the internal medical systems at Rikers. Corizon lost their contract from the city almost a year ago now, but they lost their contract in part due to those investigations that started in the Rose M. Singer with you and others. So,
and in fact, throughout the country, they've lost all of they're bankrupt now. So just by the fact that women were allowed a stepping stone, the hearing that Erica did, they were allowed to be validated as women who deserve not to be raped. This verified a structure of doctors throughout the entire nation of this company using these women, trading sexual favors for medications, putting their hands inside of their bodies because they were looking for balls. Like, I mean, just like literally extorting these women as just like walking vaginas. And I mean that. So, I mean, that's huge. That is stuff that you guys can do.
Yeah, and that is a major success.
Could I just jump in real quick, Andy, to say, since I am the sole journalist here on the panel, in terms of like the what you can do thing, I just wanted to put in a plug and bounce off what you said, which is, you know, for the aspiring journalist or practicing journalist in the room, the really the best technique I can like share with you it comes from Nicole Hannah-Jones, a reporter for The Times, actually, who basically says that, you know, we need to harness our privilege as journalists to not just cover protests, for example, shut down Rikers action, but to take the questions raised by the people we learn from who are, you know, in our interviews with those behind bars or at the protests, and take those questions to the people in power and, you know, use that as leverage for accountability. And you can see that in a way with you guys asking them to follow their own rule book, you know. It's not so much to change laws, it's an issue of accountability, and journalists can play a strong role in that when covering these social movements.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You know, and so what was going to be a question, but I'm actually going to just open it up to the whole group here, is that recently there was a Pew study released, and that Pew study showed that 67% of white Facebook users will not post about race. That's not an indication that they're biased in one way or another. It shows that they're either too afraid to talk about these issues because they may get it wrong, that they're too bigoted one way or another about the issue, or they don't know how to navigate these issues. And so we're at a place, we're at a juncture now where our country is having a conversation around race and structural racism, and a large percent of the people who hold this privilege are A, too scared to talk about it, and then B, in order to do something about it, they have to get active, which is one step beyond talking about it. So I'm going to invite the people in this room to be part of a discussion, hopefully framed as questions, but how do we take ourselves to a place where we're not only talking about these issues, we're taking that 67% down to 5% or zero, and we're moving past that to putting our bodies in the way, to doing investigations, to try and stop those officers from doing what they're doing and those systems from being structurally racist. So I'm going to open it up to discussion, and I thank the panelists tremendously for what they've provided today and their stories.
You know, at the same time this meeting is occurring, there's a group in the story that's discussing Saul Alinsky's Rules for Radicals. I was struck by that because that's a book that's about 50 years old, and hasn't anything been done about community organizing beyond Saul Alinsky? And so I want to ask you, what are your organizations doing, and what are organizations generally doing to affect the conditions in the lower income neighborhoods that prevent these kids from ending up in the system?
I just want to just maybe make one brief thing. So there is about not enough, but I'm not even going to put a number out there. So there's not enough alternative to incarceration programs. My collective runs three. I have one with my son as well. We have a simple farming project, right? My friend Ray Figueroa, he's on the council as well. He's the president of all the gardens, and we grow peppers, and then we grow hot sauce, and we pay the kids a stipend. Last year, the judges from all the media about Rikers started calling me in my office, and I worked out a program with cases where we hired them in a different track for summer youth, and instead of doing 8 months on Rikers, they're doing 20 hours a week, community service, where I then employ them for 25 hours a week to help other organizations and help other youth. The other thing is that there is no intersection between youth and the aging population. So RAP and INC and also other organizations has created an intersection with the Mid-Bronx Senior Council and also Bushwick Senior Council. And I just got 40 hand trucks donated from Home Depot and extended the Meals for Wheels program as an ATI. My friend Roy Weatherson has a program called Drive Change, and where he teaches kids culinary classes, and also as an alternative to incarceration, they do time on the truck. We have to start remembering that community service is served in the community, and who is hosting these things, right? So if it's not, then the system just uses itself for them to be cleaning up and making the courthouses better. But there is alternatives to incarceration to serve the neighborhood that is directly impacted. The other thing is that we create food pantries just for people directly impacted from the farms and the farms that refuse to sell to the prisons. Because at one time, if you was in prison, you worked on the farm and everything. So those farmers now do projects, which is actually Herman Bell's project, the Freedom Food Alliance. And then we also take those vehicles and bring them back up for free visits. And that's because, not because we have money and funding for gas, it's because diesel engines are meant to be converted to peanut oil, and we do that, and Princeton and Harvard trains their oil and sends it to us. So we have to create grassroots methods because we don't have support. right? You guys are paying taxes, that little monetized mount on your check that you never see, majority of it's going because you pay $160,000 per person on Rikers, and we are using isolation in forms of torture more, four times over the national average, so it's gonna cost you more. And then your governor, who told us as well, and told me myself personally, well, I will never undo what my dad did because he paid $1 million for each solitary sub, but we pay 76 for two facilities alone, 76 million just for two. And then we have 60-something counties in the state, right? Every county is named after a prison. So prison is America, and it's definitely New York. So we have to create alternatives, and I think, what are we doing? We're struggling to take care of each other. I got men, women, and children that come through my office every day with draft bags. Why are they gonna eat that night? How am I gonna get them to where they help? I have to get them into the shelter. The shelter's full, I still got 60 plus, right? What are we doing? I have this struggle system, but we do it together, and it takes a part of citizenship too, because everybody's returning to your county. So people are turning to your community. So I turn that question into, what are you doing in your community to support the returning citizens who all have to come back? Sorry, except for Park Slope, that's totally gentrified.
Wait, so there's definitely gonna be a sign-up sheet of some sort over there, a makeshift one at least, where the students here can possibly sign
right
up?
Right now, they're approving live ammunition, shotguns, and tasers for Rikers Island.
That's really scary for a number of reasons, and I'm sure we definitely need a panel just about that alone. But will you have a sign-up sheet over there for everybody here to get involved on a listserv? Okay.
Just quickly, El Puente is a human rights organization based in Brooklyn, New York. Has anybody heard of El Puente? Okay, cool. So they're using music, art, culture, and liberation to support young people from the ages of 3 all the way up until they're adults. It's free programming, and the goal is to really have creative, supportive environments where young people have a place to go to really have, like, holistic support, so body, mind, spirit, and community. So that's happening, and that's happening in the projects throughout all of Brooklyn, and that's an incredible nonprofit, and there's many more like that as well. But that's just one example of what is working, is really tapping into young people and ensuring that they have people, adults who care about them and their well-being, and who are providing free programming that speaks to their spirits and their souls.
And will you also have some sort of sign-up sheet?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
Got it.
So the gentleman in the back, followed by the nice hat right there, and then you by the pillar. So the gentleman in the back.
White privilege to fight Jim Crow or fight racism, but to me it just, that almost started off wrong, right? Because white privilege is in itself part of the problem. So how do you use part of the problem to address the problem, right? So that statement in itself reinforces the bottom basis of all the problems that we talked about today. The idea of supremacy, right? The conversation becomes important when white people are involved. The experience becomes more painful when it's explained by a white woman. But this experience happens every day, 10 times fold, and we don't talk about it. So I think, you know, I look forward to conversations like this, but sometimes it gets frustrating because we're not talking about what we should be talking about. We're talking about symptoms of the problem. Someone said the system is broken. The system is not broken. The system is doing what it's designed to do. And when we start talking about making change, real change, it's about having real conversations. We don't talk about slavery in America. We don't talk about race in America. You mentioned the piece in the terms of the Facebook posts, and most white people don't, you know, the white friends that I have, white people, it's very difficult because we don't come up in a culture where it's okay to talk about racism. It's okay to talk about the impact and real history and atrocity of slavery. The atrocity, the utter atrocity. Whatever you think you know about slavery, it's a million times worse than that. And there's no recognition of it. So our conversations have to be real. It has to be real. Because when we talk about using white privilege to address a system that was created because of white supremacy, we're not having a real conversation. We're not. And we're not talking about poverty. We're not talking about how the system is designed to perpetuate this and how poverty is an industry. How the field of mental health has become an industry of profit on poor people and poor communities. How the prison system is that part of that industry. So we could talk about Rikers, those are just droplets, all right? So, I mean, this is a powerful institution of education. And so we need to have those real conversations in here and not the academic conversations and that sound great and we can write great books about it. But we've been having this kind of conversation ever since I was in college. And it's still the same conversation. And I haven't been in one of these things in a while, but it felt like I was just here yesterday. Mm. All right? So that's not really a question. I'm sorry.
It's appreciated.
It's great to see Hernan.
Thank you.
All right? So great. Thank you.
Thank you.
You'll stay and talk to people, right? You can't just drop a bomb like that and then not have other conversations afterwards. The nice hat. The question is, do any of you have any connections to the Fortune Society?
Yes, yes. So the position I was actually pushing for, they actually appropriated one person to the Board of Corrections, Stanley Richards. The Fortune Society, yes, is made up predominantly most people directly impacted, but these are also people who have to sleep outside of a room waiting for the next person to transition, and they take a year to transition. There's not enough support, right? Like I said, about the prison industrial complex being an extension of slavery past the whole convict leasing law period, that is still happening, right? Otherwise, we can open up 10 buildings and solve that. We have 60,000 people. But yet, we have people in Queens who are protesting a homeless shelter in their community or protesting the development of structures for where people can live, right? Because it's too privileged. I make $107,000. I don't want a homeless shelter right here, right? But meanwhile, like I told Renee at one time, we was in Democracy Now on 23rd Street, and they was like, don't you used to live around here? I was like, yeah, because I used to tell people that. You have to have a mask when you're doing this work. Yes, I'm homeless. Yes, I'm living in a shelter. And they're like, where you live? Well, I live in Chelsea. I'm like, oh, okay. Right? Yeah, I live in a homeless shelter in Chelsea, right? So the concept of that, because I wouldn't have been validated unless I did that, and I wouldn't have been able to have the work done that we've achieved before that, right? So you have to also push yourself to this table. So yes, Fortune does do a job, but they also get government funding and state funding, so they can never be on the stand and say that Mayor de Blasio is not doing shit, that you have to lie to Pont to get things done, right? That you have to slip like the program in this school in, because we had to fight to get that in, right? And we also had to play nice to get that in. And you shouldn't have to do that when it's needed and it's warranted. So Fortune does do great work, but they can't do advocacy work in some sense. This is why David said, you know what, I'm gonna make another foundation with my name on it and just do all of that through that. So yes, they do work that's overcrowded. They don't have enough space. I got people and I work with them to transition those elders and people out who are doing long-term into permanent housing. But they are a part of the solution. We call them POTS, just a part of the solution, you know? They don't have it all, but it's a part of the solution.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure. Hi. Ooh. So I'm a storytelling coach with The Moth, and I just founded with a colleague of mine there who is also a lawyer, an organization. We've talked a lot about dehumanization and a lot about narrative, and I think narrative is the most powerful force on earth. Yes. And I think that what we see as an issue that's happening specifically in the justice system is that it's, I think there are conversations about the narratives that are happening in the conversations about race, and that there's an acknowledgement that there is a narrative out there that is destructive to black and brown people, like deadly on a daily basis, but it seems that what's getting thrown back at them to counteract this narrative is like a giant pile of a list of facts. And a list of facts is not a narrative that's powerful, you sort of turn it off. And so we've founded this organization to try and work with public defenders to help them put the narratives of the people at the hearts of their cases in front of judges or in front of adjudicants of anybody in a case. So my question is, it really came out of what Five started talking about in the beginning, which is I can't escape, and my partner and I, who is also a very privileged white woman, we're like two little white ladies gonna try to do it, like, and we are acutely aware of that. Mm-hmm. How that is us bringing our skills that we have that came from our privilege. We are trying to open up the doors for listening, and we're trying to pass on those skills to the people so that they can construct their own stories and make them heard. And I guess my question is, since we're just starting out and we've had a couple of things out there and things seem to be, people are responding to this idea,
what do we do? Like, where do we go to try and connect with people to make sure that we are finding the people whose stories need to be told and telling them in a way and getting the, like, sort of what do we do? Yeah. That might be a really personal, like, help me question.
It may be something that could be long. I would love to connect with you. So we also do consultation. That's what we do. And we create curriculum because we have another collective called the Center for New Leadership, which is just people with academic degrees. So when it comes to that, we're saying that's not an excuse anymore because we have every degree in the book and a whole group, and they're all previously incarcerated too.
Yeah.
So the other thing is that I would love to work with you and help you in that aspect because those directly impacted do have the most powerful stories. And you're not going to hear about what the real system is until you talk to them. I am just an organizer to try to put the pieces together as I try to as much. And then support as well. So what you're doing is actually part of the solution, right? Literally taking what you can do and saying, how can I assist this, right? Like, I don't have the greatest amount of money. I can't fund you, but I could help do this and create that. And that is valuable. And if everyone did that in a certain part, it would be a common conversation, you know? Another thing is like, a good friend of mine, and when we had to, just to make a comment on a post, Piper, she said when she came home, she lost most of her Facebook friends. Like, everybody was like, oh, they're on Facebook. So she had like a million friends. And then they all dropped off when she started saying, yeah, I was just in prison, and this person and that person. And then so you lose that. So I think that the Facebook thing and the social media is that you don't want to be able to taint your own circle, right? And I say the same thing with legislators. John F. Kennedy's great-grandson, JFK, John F. Kennedy III, he came to New York to talk to us in a campaign in Jim Crow and me and myself about what can he do in his state, but I can't alienate my constituents. So I said, all right, you came from Harvard to support my student group there, which I now have the nation's largest student group, and give Henry Louis Gates the Kennedy Center, right, which he did. And then he created Root Media and all these other aspects. But it starts from finding out what the root of the problem is and, like you said, making those connections.
I just want to jump in here also as someone who's worked on the whole storytelling aspect. One thing is you might create an internship opportunity, and people that you're interviewing might have, and we talked about how do we change the communities where people are coming from, you know, they just need certain opportunities, and you might actually learn a lot from having them who have families, who are family members who are incarcerated, like can help you with the organization, have insights, you know. And it's also an opportunity for them to learn about the media making process. So if that's an opportunity there, I'd suggest that. Also, I think you could push yourself a little bit and not just talk to folks who are getting out, but to talk to folks behind the walls. Mm-hmm. And that's not easy, but those voices, as we talked about earlier, you know what's happening inside. And so if we're talking about changing that, I think it would be good to include them. One thing, for example, when I interviewed Fareed for this article up here, which I'm pushing about rap, which we've mentioned several times, you know, I forget if it was he or somebody else explained, you know, they're talking about releasing elderly people from prison. And he said, you know, I mean, if you talk about it with people that are inside or with people who are recently released, they're going to tell you it's not about getting handrails in prison. It's about getting people out. So, you know, you just learn this kind of framing. I did anyway, you know, from listening to those folks and again, going behind the walls in addition to talking to people that are out.
In addition to storytelling and writing stories, I think there is a powerful story for sale here, and that's Cecily's. There's a book over there. If you want to get a signed copy, find her. Shameless plug for the Nation Books and others. But I do know that we're running low on time. I would really love permission from the New School to stay a few minutes more because there are a lot of important things being said. So if folks do want to leave or they have to leave, be sure to pick up a book, pick up information from the groups that are involved. But I want to see if we could trudge through a few more people, recognize them in the room, and make sure that we could...
And if you do want to spend more time talking or whatever, get involved with especially a group I hold, you know, dear to my heart, a group of people, Occupy Wall Street, that have been involved on the trenches of everything going on, not only in New York, at the forefront, but all the way to the pipeline, et cetera. There is, at Scratcher Bar tonight, we are, I don't know if they know it, but we're occupying this bar. So a bunch of, you know, really interesting activists. Michael Gold-Rotarsky is having a book talk right now at the New York Public Library, and we're actually merging those two crowds. So if you want to be around like-minded people and start to feel like what it means to start moving or whatever, I mean, start by Occupy drinking.
And Cecily, I don't mean to cut you short, but that's Scratcher Bar later on. I think we have two folks here. I definitely want to hear from the gentleman in the hat.
Thank you very much. I'd like to acknowledge the appreciation for the comments the gentleman over here made, because I was thinking about some of the things that you commented on. And one of the things that I would ask the audience is, why are you here? That's what you should ask yourself. Why are you here? What you can do? You know, whether you live in an affluent neighborhood or underprivileged neighborhood, the problem is that we have a problem. It's an American problem. We have a problem that's spreading throughout our communities. I've been in prison 45 years. I've seen the prison system change. When I first went to prison, only people that was in prison was, I mean, like criminals, you know, or the bank robbers, they hung out together. The stick-up guys, they hang out together. And, you know, everything was separated. But after years and years passed by, I started seeing a lot of working guys come to prison, guys that had families. And so I started seeing a lot of white guys. When I first went to prison, it was more white guys in prison than black guys. They ran everything. Then because everything changed. And so I see the same thing that's happening out in our communities now. When I come out of prison, I see black and white and green and blue and all, everybody, you know, together. Before, whites was by themselves. It was a polarization was pronounced in black communities, white communities. It's not that pronounced now. I don't see it that like that now. And so when we talk about prisons, and prison sucks, believe me, prison sucks. I could tell you many horror stories about prisons. I've been through all types of stuff, but that's here and there. The problem is that the horror of the whole thing is that it affects our whole society. Our society is crumbling. Mm. Our society is crumbling around crime, around politicians, man, that's taking advantage of poor people and affluent people, people that's doing well, and they pitting us against each other. And so you have to ask yourself, should I care about these guys in prison coming out or staying in? You got to ask yourself that. Is it important for us to support knocking down prisons? Not all prisons, but bottom line is that in this country is that, you know, the most violent people should not be out in society. I hate to say that, and some of the guys, man, is going to probably put a rope around my neck from saying this, but we have some people, man, that's real dangerous that can't function in society, have to be in a controlled environment. We understand that. But the majority of people that's in prison do not need to be in prison. Mm-hmm. All right? If you do something wrong, you can redeem yourself. You can change yourself. I was a bad person before I went to prison. I don't think that I'm really a bad person now, because I've seen different changes in myself, and I've seen what's happening in our society, and I've seen what's happening in prisons. And I've listened to some of the things that's here, and like, it didn't seem like we was really talking about what you pointed out, real issues, you know. And but it was important for those things that was brought out that was being said as well. Because what happens is that when we start coming in groups and talking about things, everybody think that what they have to say is more important than what everybody else have to say. Mm-hmm. You know, we all think that. But no, you know, but my thoughts to me is just as important as your thought is to you, and perhaps even more, you know. So what I would ask you to do is ask yourself, is it important for us as people of the world, as people of the United States, to look and say, listen, wait a minute, changes have to be made, otherwise our country is going to, see, we're in a, this is a power, look, it's like I got a bomb right here just ready to explode. Racism, man, is getting bad. We have guys around that's promoting that. All in the politics. I mean, we talking about the leaders of the country. And both parties is bad, so I agree.
You know, I think one thing that he underscored was the importance of listening. And if there are other folks who were formerly incarcerated that are in this room, I think that we should try to prioritize listening to them if they have their hands up. You also don't have to feel compelled to talk either, but, you know, we should do our best to listen to those folks. Over on this side of the room, sir, right there.
Thank you. I wanted to ask about a collaboration because I've seen the decarceration with 15 now about low wages, suppressing workers' rights, and instead finding the prison, both the prison and military complex. So just how much work is being done between decarceration and 15 now about the $15 an hour minimum wage? Is there becoming more and more of a direct working relationship between those two movements?
So the question in a nutshell had to do with the Fight for 15 movement that's arguing for a $15 minimum wage and the Cut 50 movement, which is a goal to cut the prison population in half by 2030, and if there's ways that you could pair the two movements. You know, I think there is, especially around income. We do have to watch for Trojan horses when it comes to some of these bipartisan pieces of legislation that are coming through now. We're seeing lots of coalitions, which I'm not trying to shy away from coalitions, watching Newt Gingrich and Van Jones and other folks get together is a good thing on one hand, and it's also a bad thing on others, because having David Koch fund your organization to fight for a reduction in prisons, only to find out that David Koch and his allies would like to see a privatized aftercare style workfare program that takes individuals and with the threat of having them in prison, as opposed to being in prison, no longer be incarcerated, but instead working for sub-minimum wage with the threat of going to prison if you disobey your employer, et cetera, is a future that they're trying to fight for. And so it's something that we need to consider as deeply problematic, that in when we fight to cut these prisons in half, are we also jeopardizing creating a whole new form of chattel yes. in the free world? And I think... Hernan, you know more about policy five.
So I actually worked on the Fair Chance Act for 2 years with Cory Booker on this, and we created a film called Prison Kids. And the night on the 27th, we're in the White House doing this, and it's me, it's Van, it's Mark Holden, and he represents the Koch brothers. And it's funny because their organization is called Cut 50. I'm like, well, you guys own like most of the prisons, so you probably could just cut them in half and just close them. So that's easy for them, right? The other thing is that as an advocate, it's hard, right? Because I feel like I'm back in court. And all like most people directly impacted are in court, and you have 100 years or you choose that 5 years, right? So the legislation also created funding for organizations which they already had there to spear catch and to sort of catch. The year before that, me and Piper sort of stuck up the congressional hearings with Ted Cruz because he wanted to do that. So his Right on Crime people were actually the recipients for that, right? So we see the system sort of supporting itself, but then you're caught in a situation as in saying, what if you do? Because if you don't, then nothing's going to happen, right? So you have to create these incremental changes, but also stay on their back. So yes, you hear in the front page of the Times, which I still love Swartz for doing, but yes, you see it and you say, oh, well, they now have $6 million that they can create different language for housing. Yeah, but they gave that $6 million to HUD to create their own language for housing. And when they did in the first place, they just excluded all felons with the Clintons. And of course, they're running on that same campaign today, who created the $30 billion crime bill who we're still fighting with. So the system ended up re-supporting itself. Now, it did some great things. Okay, it let out people out of prison who were overcharged anyway, right? We had 29,000 people released from solitary. It was like, oh, that's great. No, that's not. They were overcharged anyway. And 6,000 of them went in just for tattoos, and two of them were Chinese. And it was like we had to be the smallest gang, or we're just not that tough, right? So these systems, and it actually looks like a victory, like, oh, we did all of this in the BOP system, but this is also the man that same year didn't even know the size of a cell, right? And also when we appropriate advice, because do not think that a lot of media angles, I'm sorry, because I know this is supported by a media organization, but those media organizations are also depicting the wrong pictures, right? Because you see the BOP Stevens, you see Vice there, and you see HBO. Okay, we did that. All right, Vice, that was helped by a good friend of mine, Nick Malinowski, who writes for Vice as well, and created that collaboration. My students, or the students who run Fusion, who did that project, and it was a measure of then HBO, who we did like 60-something documentaries with, came in and combined it, and we shot the president in a cell. And we wrote the articles afterwards because he was like, the world's different. He was like, really? Because when these people get out of prison, it's gonna be a whole different world. So you see these solutions, but they're not. Like you see Commissioner Pont and you see de Blasio talking about solitary's ended. No, it's not. It's because people have actually fought that. Activists, organizations like Jails Action Coalition and other groups as well have been out there supporting it and rallying, actually creating, saying, you don't have rules, you have minimum standards. So we're gonna take that and show you what rules look like and then play that process of actually being there on the constant force. How many people have ever been to a Board of Corrections hearing? How many people been to a city council hearing, right? How many people even know who their city councilman is? How many people know who their senator is? How many people know who their assemblyman is, right? How many people even registered voters in this room? So this is the conversations that we need to have, right? And also, how are you a citizen talking about, I pay too much of taxes? Really, what are you doing about it? How are you addressing that? So I just say that because we see these solutions, but that Fair Chance Act, which maybe made me jump back on the stage, was something that was like, it wasn't no silver bullet. And of course, it's bipartisan because Eric Holder, of course, gave them a bailout. Like, people was smuggling millions of dollars from the Mexican cartel, and they got a fine? Right? No jail time. So as corporate America is now being incarcerated, then we start seeing the changes of the rules.
And we had, I think it's a
actually, for out of respect for folks that have, you know, that have been impacted by the system, I think that we should try to...
That's what I'm saying is there's two hands in the back over here that when you said had been formerly incarcerated. So I was going to draw back that.
Oh, yeah. I wanted to acknowledge folks that are on paper in case they have to get home at a certain time, that maybe we should wrap the panel as it is and continue the conversations in this room over signing books or interpersonal conversations or down at the bar at Scratcher.
Sure.
Scratchers.
Okay.
Okay.
209 East 5th Street. All persons are welcome, and you don't need to necessarily buy a drink. Yeah. There will be enough people buying drinks that you won't feel obligated.
So the conversation's not over. It's just that this panel is over.
Yeah. Yes. Give yourself a round of applause. That was a lot.
I know, but I got this.
Yeah, I know.